my best life. Said I'm living my best life. Made a couple M's with my best friends. Turned on my L's.
What up, world? This is Jay Liggs, and this is the Culture Cure. We got a very special show today. I got a couple special guests in the building. Just want to have a good conversation with y'all. Once again, this show, The Culture Cure, we're about bringing the positivity back into the city. You know, every time you turn on the radio, the news, and things of nature, the city is always viewed as in a very negative way. So that's what this show is about, bringing back the positivity, showing everybody what we actually are really doing here in Detroit, and we're going to get right to it. First of all, I want to introduce a special guest, one of my friends is going to help me co-host today. Tiff, how you doing today?
I'm good. Right. I'm real good.
Glad you're here.
Thanks for having me.
Got all them big words with you today?
No. I'll try to use my 10-cent words.
No, I need the big words today.
We'll see what I can do.
No, I need the big words.
Okay.
All right, whatever. All right, cool. So we're going to get right to it, though. I got one of my friends, man. We've been down for about, 4 years now?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he was tossing bags at Delta, huh?
Yeah.
I got my man's in the building, Bob Shell. He on here. We gonna have a little sit down with him. He's a artist that's doing some amazing things in the city. He actually dropped a song not too long ago called John Q. That was it did something for me when I lost my grandmother earlier this year. So I appreciate him for that. But we gonna jump right into it, man. What's up? How you doing?
I'm good.
What's up, man? So tell the world, tell Wayne State and Detroit, you know, who you are and what you got going on, and who is Bob Shelby and what's what.
Man, I'm Bob Shelby. That's all I am, man. I'm out here trying to do this music. Basically, through my music, I tell my truth. I was out here rapping like everybody else, same old stuff that wasn't true. Pump faking, and my mama passed away, and I just said I ain't want to lie in my songs no more. Went from there.
That's deep, man. So you a hometown boy, right?
You say what?
You from the city, right?
Yeah.
What part of the city?
Schoolcraft.
Oh, okay.
So, oh, wow.
What high school you go to?
Yeah. Well, I went to Northwestern for a minute, and then yeah, only ninth grade, and I left from there and went to River Rouge.
Okay.
It was safer.
Really? River Rouge was safer than Northwestern? That's crazy, because I stayed, you know where, remember the original Steve's Old Hoop?
Where
at? On Grand River?
No.
I remember.
I stayed down the street from that. Yeah. So Northwestern was too safe. That was my neighborhood high
school. Well, no, when I was in high school, I used to stay right across the street from Motor City. You remember where Jersey Town was at?
Yeah.
I literally walked to Jersey Town every day to get my fake forces.
The one to start the pill?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's why I had to get some up, but it was only like $20.
Yeah, $20.
Where them boys 2 weeks.
Hurry up. Wink. And nobody know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then like the bottom and the top started to change colors.
And you know the front of them was square instead of circle.
I'm so not familiar.
I mean, whoever said, ain't nobody said ain't no future in your front. You know what I'm saying?
I appreciate it.
I was that man with them fake forces, but mine was always white.
That's what's up, man. So, went to River Rouge, and then what happened up at River Rouge?
Military.
Oh, yeah.
Joined the military, did that thing, came back, and then started a business.
Let's talk about that for a little bit, because one of the things about this show is that we want to promote entrepreneurship. People are here stepping away from the regular 9-to-5 and building something for themselves, building their own piece of the pie. So, let's talk about that for a second.
I started a small glass company called Glass Guy. It's kind of crazy that the name was not taken, but it's called the Glass Guy. I do auto glass, so, your window break, windshield crack, or something like that, I come and get you together, put you a new one in, at your house or your job, right there on the spot.
How long you been doing that?
I've been knowing how to do it since I was, like, 15. Once the military came back, I was working with my pops doing it for a minute, and then why not get this easy money?
What part of the military you went to?
I went to the Navy.
Okay.
How long were you in?
I did 4 years, the active, and then I went inactive for 4 years. Well, I went ready reserve active for a year, and then I went inactive for 3 years.
Did you ever get deployed?
Ship, just
on the ship.
Just cruises, stuff like that. But
how was that, man? Been on the show for like, what, 4, 5, 6 months at a time?
Yeah, I mean, forget what day it is.
With all the men?
Yeah, ain't no, it's girls. It's girls. You really can't do nothing. I mean, but I ain't about to put their business out there, but the military, the Navy is crazy. It's like,
it's a whole other world.
Oh, when I say, man, you wouldn't believe it unless you're there. You think people just, you know, man, it.
Yeah,
no, just put it like this, right, man.
We're going to leave that.
At least you said, I want a crazy story.
I just wouldn't want no wife in the military. You know, I don't want no wife on no shit. Put it like that.
Okay.
Man, they be on there. We know you got that work boyfriend.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah. The plant life? Oh, boy, you know how they be in the plant?
Boy, you stop somewhere overseas, you the same dude that was shaking your hand is, you know.
That's the work husband.
You know,
oh, wow.
That's the work husband with your girl in that hotel room, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I just like, dang, it's crazy. You know, but.
Okay, so military came back, became the glass guy. How's that been working out for you?
Glass guy pay my bills.
How is it in the winter though? Like, does it slow down?
Yeah, it slowed down around like November because people say I'm gonna wait till after Christmas. Mm-hmm. People don't want to spend money because it's Christmas, mm-hmm. And then right after Christmas they call and be like, I might as well wait for income tax.
Tax know? Time's got to be good for you.
You know, so then oh yeah, so usually I'm slow from like November to February, so. I got to save up a lot of money during the year because all my bills, I still got a son who own everything, and I still want to have fun.
Yeah.
So I stack up a lot, but I be broke when February come around that, boy. It be like the last dollar spent, and somebody called me like, yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So how is it juggling, you know, the job and, you know, your music that you spoke about in the beginning and having a business?
Well, I mean,
being a father too, like you mentioned.
Well, owning your business, you kind of free. You kind of set up everything, set mm-hmm. your own times. Especially if you lazy like me, you know, I probably can make a lot more. But boy, when I say,
you ain't having it.
I take advantage of being my boss, my own boss. I would push somebody off like, oh man, your glass, it did not come in today, man.
Oh no.
I'm gonna do you tomorrow. You know what I'm saying? It's the thing is, people wait because you call SafeLight for a 2012 Charger. They're mm-hmm. gonna charge you $400. You call me, the glass guy. I'm charging you $150.
Okay, glass guy.
Oh yeah.
I guess I'll wait a day.
Yeah, I'll gladly wait.
I'll wait till next week, sir.
Hey, Cody, you waiting next week?
Yeah, I'll wait.
You know, so that's the big thing about it. That's why I'm happy. Like, man, it's just me. So, you know, it's cool.
So you hiring? Because I need another job.
I'm actually right now I'm looking for building and everything. I never wanted to expand. This is the year I'm starting to search for expand on everything that I do. You know what I'm saying? So I'm looking for a building. I've been calling people trying to get buildings. So once I get the building, I got my little brother already taught him how to do it. My cousin know how to do it. So send him out on the road, and I train people inside the building. And hopefully after a year, I ain't doing glass no more. You know, I'm going to just pay other people to do glass.
Makes sense.
You know.
So you just keep it in the family?
Well, yeah. You never want to get some money?
No, I'm talking about, like, right now. Like.
Oh, right now? Yeah. It's just because they, you know, you can pay them, you know, little cousins, little brothers, like, hey, I'm going to throw you. I mean, it's still good money because I'm paying you $100 a day. Yeah. You know, you work 5 days with me, you walk away with $500, and you only cash. Work 3 hours a day.
Right, cash.
You know, mm-hmm. you work 3 hours with me and walk away with $500, $1,000 every 2 weeks, but I give you a junk on Friday. McDonald's, you and that boy all day. You ain't getting no $1,000.
You getting $400. Not even now.
Are you hiring is the real question.
Where can somebody reach you?
Right.
I put my app in it. You know I'm the king of 15 jobs.
I am willing to learn.
I mean, like I say, that's the next step. The next step is doing that. But I have to better myself first. I gotta not be lazy. Have to want it. Me not wanting it is I don't want to waste nobody else's time because I like being able to sit down.
I mean, I think that's the what they consider the American dream, to build something where it sorts. You can sit back and just, recoup and just enjoy the fruits of your labor. So if you get
but I don't even want to do the labor to enjoy the fruit. You know what I'm saying? Like I get 6 jobs, 7 calls today. I swear, I wake up like, man, that's a nice day. You know, I'm walking, it's $800 a day. It's like, I'm going to do 4. I'm going to just push the rest over to tomorrow. Cause I just don't want to do, I don't want to do that many, but it all matters. Some days is, you know, some days better. You know, you get three Benzes sitting on, you know, that's $15,000-$2,000 a day, you know.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that glass is pretty expensive.
Yeah, so I can charge them all. I know Safe Light charged them $1,200. I'm going to charge you $800. You save
that's
a lot.
Still a good deal.
You're still winning. And I still came up $400.
I got a better product and I'm selling it cheaper.
Yeah. No, it ain't even better. We all get it from the same place. I see them in the morning too. We get the same glass.
Oh, wow.
I see them in the morning.
You are giving away trade secrets.
Oh, yeah. Safe Light gonna call him. As soon as it's air. Like, my mans, what's up?
Can I talk to you for a minute?
Hey, come here, sir.
These people getting their stuff from the same place.
They gonna tap you in the surgery like they did to Kevin Hart. Hey, come here, sir. Come here. You put your phone out. Come here.
I need you to come with me.
Right now.
Crazy.
That's what's up, man. So, you said, you know, situation happened with your mom, and that's what got you into music. So, how did music become, it was like your diary or something? That's like, what was it for you?
Well, it's easy. To me, I mean, writing the music was already, for one, I don't write, so I just freestyle everything. It ain't because I think I'm sweet, and my lungs collapse, so I can't write something down and then try to say it because I probably won't be able to say it. So I had to learn how to just rap whatever in my mind, because I ain't got the lungs to do what everybody else can do.
You said your lung collapsed.
Yeah, like I had two scars under both my arms, twice actually collapsed. So like my lungs are smaller, so I can't write down no 16 and then think I'm about to rap it because I'm gonna run out of breath. So a lot of people be like, man, you be sounding like J. Cole sometimes, like how I cut off my words or something. Mm-hmm. They be thinking I'm trying to do that. Like, no, that's how I talk. That's how I breathe.
Dang, I did not know that.
That sounds like a major story.
Yeah, so like when I get louder on some parts of my song, like people think I'm trying to do J. Cole. I'm not. I'm just rapping.
I mean, was that a touchy story? Like, how did you know?
It collapsed when I was a kid, when I was born. My lungs collapsed, and then it collapsed again. Around like 2009, 2010, I just fainted, you know. It ain't like it's so sad. It's just I filled up with blood and I passed out.
You passed the test to get into the military, so.
Yeah, you feel me?
You're all right.
I can run. You know, I can run a mile and a half. I'm good. You know?
Jesus Christ. Well, yeah. I guess it's a good story. That's what's up. So, let's talk about this. So, being an artist in Detroit, huh? You know, a lot of people feel this was Motown and all that, and this is where the music should be coming from. Or it should be, you know, we should have a lot more going here than we do. And it's kind of like you get that same old song that all Detroit music sounds the same. Like,
I feel like everywhere all music sound the same. It's just what everybody else want to hear what sound the same. So you had the Texas when everybody was chopping, screwing everything. Everybody wanted to hear chopping, screw. Right now, how many people you know want to hear something, your favorite song slow down?
Yeah, that's over. That wave is gone.
I wasn't on that wave when it was hot.
Yeah, I wasn't either, but the world was
tripping on 4-4.
But people wanted to hear that. And then you had, you know, the New York, the Atlanta wave, the country voice. If you got a Maine in your voice, people want to hear it. You know, so people want to hear it because the country sound has like a pain in it. The voice has a pain in it, so you got all these people just saying they stories and they songs. It just sound painful, and then they singing it, raps thing. I don't know what they doing, but they like humming it or something. But Detroit sound just, to me, is just too hard. Detroit sound is like N.W.A. start all over again. Like, wait,
it's gritty.
They don't want it. Like nobody. The world don't want to listen to people sing. Have you hear the thug songs? Like, you hear T.I., the trap music. Like, T.I. created trap music. You hear all these people talk about they stuff. You hear Detroit? It's like, I don't know if we, and I think we might be saying the same thing. It's just the way we say it.
You feel it a little differently.
You feel a different way afterwards.
So you see it, you hear an Atlanta song. By the end of the song, you danced and everything, but the whole song, if you listen to the word, it was a dude talking about his heart was broke. He about to kill himself 6 times. I'm trying to think, what's the name of that dang song? The junk's so live to me, too. It's so live to me. But if you listen to the words, the guy, I think he's trying to kill himself in the song. It's called Lucid Dreams.
Oh, Lucid. I knew what you was talking about.
So you hear this?
Yeah. I like that song.
Now I love it, but I don't know if I'm trying to kill myself when I'm singing it or not. I don't know.
Like, I don't know if I should be vibing to this.
I think they brought that up. Like, they were saying a lot of this music almost sound like a cry for help. Mm-hmm. Like, someone needs to go and check on these people.
Or All My Friends Are Dead. Like, you got all these songs, so you got these people singing their songs. Even the hood songs that's saying, I can't say the words, but you know, like, what's his name? One who used to wear all the little clothes. Young Thug. Yeah. Like, favorite one of the verses was when he come on, some come to your crib and dip. Right. But you know what he talking, what he said when he come to your crib and dip. So it was just like, man, if a Detroit person say this, it ain't going to have this singing melody to make you not know what the words is talking about. We gonna tell you
exactly
what we talking about.
There's no finesse.
There is no finesse.
They're not making it pretty for
your
you.
Kids ain't gonna sing it in a way where you have to, like, wait a minute. Brandon, what did you say? It's like, no.
It's gonna be like old school. I put semen on your feet.
Yeah. Pull up the very first
deep,
from the first up. Word, your please, parent please. Gonna be like, wait a minute.
I put a hole in you in the side of a CD.
So your parents might get the dance into the melody and all that to the old songs.
Caught off guard.
But here, as soon as the beat come on, you're going to be like, oh, no. No, no, no.
How do you feel about that, though? Do you think that's a flaw? Think that stops Detroit artists?
Yeah. Like I say, man, people want to move. Detroit rappers, now you got Sada Baby doing a little moving. But most part, the most you can do is bob your head faster. That's really it. Or you look at the person you like or your enemy and rap the words. You know, you can rap it to your homie and y'all laugh and smile like, yeah, because I do that. Or you can rap it to the person you don't like, I do this to you. So it's either or. That's it.
You ain't got nothing else. You got two moves.
And it hit me when I went out of town and I played First Day Out. So I went out of town and I played First Day Out. I played it in Atlanta. Man, when I say, people looked at me like I was crazy. It took the radio waves to grab it for everybody to start catching it. But when I say, man, when I played it, people looked at me like I was angry.
What's wrong?
Somebody needs to watch this guy.
We had a truck full of people, and I'm like, no, play this. Play that. I was the only one moving. Everybody like, man.
Someone needs to go home with him. Like,
I think he's a thug.
We need to put him on watch.
Hey, Detroit music is crazy. But to me, all music be saying the same stuff. Country songs be saying the same back that booty up stuff.
Yeah.
They got the Daisy Duke songs. They got the sad and the angry beat you up songs. It's just the way you say it.
They have a lot of.
Yeah. I mean, everybody's saying the same thing.
Yeah,
it's just all in the delivery.
Yeah, and Detroit delivery is.
It's in your face.
Man, Detroit delivery, I think if you like a girl in a song, it sound bad. You know? You might be trying to take her on a date, but boy.
Snatch it up. Put you in the car. Now exactly. We go.
The only people that understand it is Detroit girls.
Like, oh, I like that.
You know, yeah.
That sound fun.
And your friend from Alabama, like, wait a minute.
Call somebody.
Like, I paid for this weave. You feel You know what I'm saying? Like, this is expensive. The things he was saying, you know, Detroit girls like, yes. Yes.
Say it to me again.
Yeah, one more time. They rapping a song with you.
Tough, too. Like, in the mirror, out the window.
Yeah.
Oh, man. That's crazy. So, like, I think you said something, too, like, when the beat come on. To me, it sounds like, okay, so there are a couple of heavy producers in the city, like, Hell of a... and a couple other people, but it seems like everybody is trying to mimic that same dun, dun, dun. It's like that gritty sound,
man.
and that's the sound.
But to me, that's everybody's sound. Like I said, you go to Atlanta, they got that sound. Man, when I say you listen to Lil Baby and Young Thug and them right now, them beats all sound the same, and they all ride it the same way, and to me, they all sound the same. Same thing with Detroit, is just being from there. Like when you first heard Future, and then when who was that came out? Somebody thought Future, the other Panda guy was Future.
Designer?
Oh, yeah, Designer.
Now you can hear them because they've been out for a while. But at first, you could not tell the difference between them two people. You had to actually, he come out, you heard it so many times, and then you like, wait a minute, okay, they do sound different. So if you're not from Detroit, you just think everybody sound the same. Because I did, you know, just before, when I first started hearing it, I was like, oh, this not them. So it was like, yeah, it was like that.
That Panda song, in all honesty, I don't know how, but he sounded just like Future.
I mean, it was kind of hot, though.
But now, if you hear
it, was catchy.
But if I hear it, but for some reason, if I hear it now, it don't sound like Future to me.
No, it don't.
Because you know.
It don't.
Yeah.
Because you know.
So, like, same thing with Detroit rappers. I started knowing. And to me, I feel like I said, the Detroit sound, it grew on me. So, like, I grew up in it. So, it's like, I know what I'm listening for. I'm listening for the story that they tell. To me, that's why I like Detroit rap, because we telling stories. And most rap out of town, they not telling stories. They were just rhyming words. They just saying different things. People, if you listen to like a Peasy or something, they're literally the whole verse rides to a story. Mm. If you listen to a Payroll, the whole verse is a story. You listen to like Young Thug and stuff, no. You listen to Migos, no. You'd be like, woo, ha, yeah.
Check it out.
And yeah. Everybody loves it.
It's not like the bop it. Yeah. Remember you, that?
Yeah.
Bop it.
Like, I'm not sure what these words are.
If you heard that song, seen a little show when they be just reading the lyrics, other rappers read other rappers' lyrics.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, man, they be looking like, oh, this is horrible. But it be they friend's song. But they don't know the song without the beat and the melody.
And just give them the lyrics.
But if you said T Grizzly first day out, if you said it slow, you still know. It was a story. It was a storyline. So if I said his words in the same order, no matter how slow, how fast, I'm like, well, that's T Grizzly. Because it was still a sentence.
And you still get something out of it.
Yeah, it was still a story. It might have been in some raw, rough, crazy, I don't know what going on story, but it was a story. You know what I'm saying? That's why I still like the Meek Mills and all that stuff, because he tells stories. I like all Philly. They all tell stories, period.
So do you think it's necessary for Detroit rappers to maintain that? Or
Yeah. It actually is coming out. Right now, I just was on Chris Brown page like a week ago. All I heard was, ooh, RJ on Chris Brown page in China. Mm-hmm. Told him to play a Sada Baby song.
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden, I heard Chris Brown on the hook. It was a Detroit beat, RJ.
Oh.
Yeah. Ooh, RJ, China, Chris Brown. That's big.
Very.
R beats, Chris Brown on T Grizzly stuff, two times? On his album, two times? On a hell of a beat. It's awesome. They sound like Detroit beat. Lil Yachty, hell of a beat. Jeezy, hell of a beat. It's coming. It's coming.
It might be Detroit's time.
Oh, it's
coming. Everybody has their way.
Oh, no, it's coming. Right now, the female rappers went out. Now, the female ratchet rapper sound went out. Now, man, you listen to City Girls, they talking crazy.
Very.
Crazy. So right now it's all back. You know, you got a Stunner Girl from the city right now. She just talking crazy. People like it. Probably got like 50,000, 60,000 followers. People like it. Being thuggy, you know, is actually in right now. So, like I say, people can act like a thug and you in, really.
Yeah. So, how do you feel like, do you think Detroit supports its local artists?
The city, the actual fan base, yeah. The radio, I can't say no, yeah or no, because I don't know how much power they got, because I know for sure when they get in their car, they playing
right
Detroit music, but you know what I'm saying, but I don't know what can they play on the radio, because that's a different bag, that's a lot of money, it's a difference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they not just playing right here in Detroit. They playing from out of Detroit.
You probably, yeah, syndicated.
Yeah, I don't know how far it goes. So I can't play what people don't understand. You know, I understand this. Just because I speak Spanish don't mean I can play Spanish all day.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So I speak Detroit rap. And people don't know what the heck they talking about. And so I just feel like they can't. And it ain't on. That ain't what the world want to hear. That's what Detroit want to hear.
How do you think Detroit artists can make that turn?
They already doing it. Like I said, you got T Grizzly, and you got Sada Baby. You got, there's a lot of people right now. Like, I mean, I'm just so happy to be like in the middle of it and seeing a lot of it. But you seen Drago? They opened up for Beyonce when she was just here.
Mm.
That's not that dude just got out of high school.
That's not small.
That's not small. You open up for Beyonce.
Yeah, that's bad.
I don't know how many iPhones I've seen out in the crowd. You know what I'm saying? That's different, you know, and Jay-Z. You know, so that's, like I said, I don't think it's holding nobody back. Right now, it ain't about the radio. Right now, it's about Instagram. So as long as you get people to listen to you, you good. As long as you get people to, that's it. You get your own wave and you just ride it. You can be the world's most hated person. If you got enough people hating you that they want to follow you and hate you, you're going to get a check.
Mm-hmm. Well, is it only about the check?
Oh, yeah. I don't know. I mean, me, yeah, still. Like I say, I like my music different. It don't sound like Detroit. None of my stuff sound like Detroit music. Everybody, I don't like saying it, but everybody say it kind of like sound like Kanye, College Dropout. Mm-hmm. Everybody say my EP sound like College Dropout.
That's huge.
But mine is just because, like I said, I didn't make it for radio. I made it for me. My mama passed away, so I made my EP about me. I actually like went through like a depression, and I didn't even know what it was. So like I just didn't feel right. I would be Cancun, you know, it was a party. Girls was everywhere, and like tears was coming out of my eyes. But I was happy.
Mm-hmm.
I was having a blast. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It was girls everywhere. You know, tooting up. You know, so it was. I was having a blast, but some tears came out of my eyes. I had to take off for a second. Like, man, what's wrong? But I mean, after you know getting looked at or whatever, basically anxiety and depression. You know, that was it. Like you ain't letting something out. You know, and I put that in my song. My whole EP basically is surrounded by that.
All right. I think there's no better time than that just to do a segue. We have one of your songs that you sent to us that I would like, you know, for you all to hear, the world to hear, to get a little taste of Bob Shelb. You want to introduce this for us?
This song is called Love. It's not the usual like love song. It's actually a song talking to love. Like I say, it's how do I love again after losing, you know, your mama and stuff. So, you know, that's what this is about.
All right, Wayne State, take a listen to Bob Shelb.
Don't nobody sing about love no more. Don't nobody speak to you, love. It's about the women and drugs. I say I got a problem with you. The same time I miss you. I say I got a problem with you. The same time I miss you.
I ain't gon' sing to you, love, but I'm gon' speak to you. I got that beef with you the same time I fiend for you. I ain't heard from you in a while, trying to figure out where you been. I'm trying to show you to this girl, but I don't know where you live. Man, I've been crying a lot, man, I've been trying a lot. Wasting all these tears, man, I promise I'm trying to stop. It's crazy how I feel when I'm in my bed fiending for you. Boy, them tears ain't no tissues for you. You the oldest, you the strongest, you the protector. Ain't no weakness for you. And they listening, boy, they witness is you. So can I get my time back? In them pictures, can I get my smile back? What are these chains, can I get my shine back? It get hard trying to dial without no numbers to call. Scab knees without no cream, it ain't no help when you fall. Like that feeling back in school, writing letters and all. Spelling love, it get different when them letters involved. Damn.
Don't nobody sing about love no more. Don't nobody speak to you, love. It's about the women and drugs. I say I got a problem with you, the same time I miss you. I say I got a problem with you, the same time I miss you.
Don't nobody sing about love no more. Don't nobody speak to your love. It's about the women and drugs. Said I got a problem with you, the same time I miss you. I said I got a problem with you, the same time I miss you. Hey, hey, hey. Had a friend, his name was Love. He was unpredictable. In and out of my visual. Should've let her sister know. He had other plans. Help me understand. I can't tell day from night. Arguments all the time. nobody sing about love no more. Don't nobody speak to your love, it's about the women and drugs. Said I got a problem with you, the same time I miss you. I said I got a problem with you, the same time I miss you.
Yo, yo, Wayne State, that was Bob Shell with Love. I like that, man. That was a tough tone.
Yeah, it was, it made me feel a way.
Yeah, I like that. You want to give us a little backstory on that one?
Like I say, my mama passed away. I just wrote a song to love. Like I say, it's just, how do I supposed to move on when you lost something so, you know, something so close to you? So it's just like, I got a problem with you, but at the same time, I miss you, because you're like, who don't want to feel it? But, you know, you lost it, so it's kind of crazy.
That's what's we up. Were talking a second off air, and you were saying that your entire project was done after your mom, after the passing of your mom. Mm-hmm. So was that, like, therapy for you?
Oh, yeah. When I say John Q, John Q was a... Man, we cried in the studio. Like, I was just rapping. It wasn't even like, I didn't write this down. So, and we cried, for real, for real. Like I say, from the first song on my EP, it's more, it's kind of live, but it just explained me. You know, I kind of attack a couple people, you know, just Detroit rap, just saying a couple things. And I talk about being stressed, depressed and stuff. To go to a sad song, another sad song, then the fourth song and make you angry. It's more, the fourth song is called, you know, like, Forget It, but the F word. And it's basically about, you know, the kneeling and stuff and stuff like that. So it kind of make people angry, but everybody love it. People call me all the time. Then you get to the fifth song, it's about love. And then you get to sixth song, it's it brings some hood stuff. I tell a little bit about me. And then the seventh song is called Don't Know. I don't know if you heard of me and Tuck.
Yeah, I heard
Don't Know.
Yeah. Actually, yeah, we're going to have Tuck on and play that joint.
It's kind of live, but I still talk about my mama in there, you know what I'm saying? I had, like, at the end of that, I had, like, a little bar or something to say, feeling like Uncle Phil, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Everybody
yeah.
loved that part, like, man, like, you still got me sad and stuff, feeling like Uncle Phil and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
How Will and Smith and Uncle Phil did that last episode.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
That's what's up. So, you made a comment about, you know, like, depression and anxiety. Do you think, like, especially within our culture and within our city, like, with the things that we've gone through, the ups and downs, do you think a lot of artists deal with, like, mental health issues? And
to me, people in general do, like, especially dudes. You know, women definitely, you know, they go through so much. Women with being having to, you know, fend for themselves all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a big thing, to be scared every day, all day, when going and getting out the car to go to the gas station. You know, you training them from a kid to growing up to be scared when you get in the gas station. I feel like they got to do something to you. Me, my mom passed away. I didn't know what was happening. Like I say, I thought it was fake. Like, man, ain't no such thing as depression. That's just a way somebody can get them a nice little pill or something. But no, it feel crazy. It feel weird. It make you want to jump off a bridge. To me, it's the worst pain ever, for real. Like, it ain't even like a pain. It's more just, you can't control your feelings. So, like, I'm not sad. You just feel sad. Your body, your brain feels sad. You're mm-hmm. not even sad. You balling with your homies. You out at the club. But your brain is... It, to me, I told, like, my sister when I told her, because she went through a little something after having the kids and stuff, and she said, man, that's crazy. It really feel like Get Out. So it feel like two people, and it feel like you watch yourself be sad when you trying to be happy. So it really feel like you sit back inside your body. It's a horrible feeling. Like, it's to me, it's horrible.
So it seems like you're extremely open with mental health, like, so your anxiety and your depression. So what would you say to an up-and-coming artist or local artist who may be battling these same issues about being honest about it?
I say anybody, not even just artists. I say, to me, the best thing to do is talk to somebody. If you don't say nothing, you're going go crazy. Like, I ain't gonna lie, like, man. I don't know, like I say, it's not a feeling that you can explain. Like I say, to me saying it like that, it probably sound crazy, but to somebody that went through it or going through it, I promise, they probably like, man, he ain't lying. It's you really fall into yourself, and it's not you. So you hear people, like, about to kill themselves. It's like you got to, to me, it's like you got to always realize it's you. So, like, I thought, like, man, I hate this feeling. Like, I just want to jump off a bridge or kill myself. You ain't killing yourself. You trying to kill the person that keep taking over your body. That's the thing. And you got to keep realizing it's you. So, like, every time I got sad, I would be like, man, what the heck? I'm with my friends. We in Cancun, 10 deep, girls everywhere, pool party, you know. It's real wild at this time, man. I got to go take a nap. Like, I'm missing stuff. So it was just like I say, is you fighting another person. Because, like I say, I really felt like somebody else was in front of me walking with my body, and I was just behind that mug. Mm-hmm. Happy, and that person sad, making my body feel sad. It was crazy. I never want to do that junk again, but so. I just feel like the best thing to do is talk, man. If you can talk to somebody that feel it, because talking to somebody that don't, you're going to feel crazy.
So were you able to, did you go through therapy, or was music your therapy?
Music was cool because people cried with me. So, like, I ain't really crying. My mama passed away. It didn't happen. If you hear the song, you would know what I'm saying, because I tell it in the song. But my mom died by, like, a mistake at the hospital. My mom was 42 years old. My mama 17 years older than me, so you can see she kind of young. Mm-hmm. You know, I am the age my mama was when I was 15. I graduated, my mama was 34. So we was, you know what I'm saying? I used to be mad because she act young. Like, oh, why you got to add Jordans too? But
she said, I want to stay fly.
Yeah, but I didn't notice it back then. I just thought she was an old person acting young. But I'm 30, and it's like, dang, I don't feel old. So it's like, dang, my mom was young. All those times in middle school, she was in her 20s. And I was tripping, like, this old lady tripping. So she was actually 26, you know. It was crazy. But now I see it. But so my mom passed away. She slid into a home base at playing softball, broke her ankle, went to the hospital. They fixed it, but it healed wrong. So they told her to come back a year later, and they wanted to break it. They broke it. They didn't even get to break it. They gave her the anesthesia to break it, and it put her to sleep. She died.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to hear that.
So if you hear John Q, you see. That's why I say you can't play John Q in here, because it's real angry. And when I perform it on stage, man, I'm talking about people cry with me. Crowd cry with me. I go to the bathroom, man. I'm talking about, you see people with teardrops, tattoo teardrops on their face, man. One day, dude came in the bathroom with me trying to give me a hug. Like, bro, I'm peeing. You know what I'm saying? And you a thug with that tattoo on your face.
Real thug? Like, you got a purple heart.
I don't know if you just got out of prison, and I didn't drop no soap in here, cuz, but you ain't about to give me no hug until I get out of here.
Let me drop my head.
You feel me? So it was just like,
I am a boy, David.
But feeling that, man, is crazy. I post stuff on my gram all the time. When I say I got hundreds of messages from on my gram right now, I post like 20 or whatever every day. I just posted one today. Man, people be telling me from Alaska, out the country, Costa Rica. Like, people be telling me, man, like, I listen to your junk just to cry. Like, man, my mama, one dude, man, he got a whole paragraph. Like, man, my mama just in cancer, and they say she ain't going to make it. And just listening to your story, just, you know what I'm saying? People be telling me they cry every day on my music. So it's just crazy.
And that's the thing about music that I enjoy, you know, what's out now. You know, it's entertaining. But music used to be a thing that was therapeutic. Like, you used to be able to put on something, and it took you either to a place.
Were you trying to get your tears off?
Yeah, it took you to a place to do what you need to do, whether you were happy or sad. Or if you were just in a moment and you were sad and you need to be happy, you can put on something from back in the day that took you to a time.
Or that time back when you know what I'm saying, you get that letter that's folded up 19 times and dropped in your locker, and if you pull it right here, it unfolds.
Oh yeah.
So you put on some type of Usher or something at the time. Not Confessions, it was before Confessions.
Yeah,
you know,
before people was being burned.
He was crying.
Yeah.
You threw on something else, like, I'm about to open this letter and read it to this.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
You know,
go back down memory lane.
Me and my girlfriend wrote a letter between hours, like, I didn't see her last hour. So what did you do in third hour, girl? You know, I love, man. That is crazy, man. I swear I was just talking about the adjunct. It's crazy.
Yeah, so music is not that anymore. Like, I don't think I'm going to.
I think there's still some of that around.
Yeah, you got.
What? Give me one right
Detroit
now.
Detroit rap make you angry, cuz.
Hey, just
okay,
told you.
Not Detroit rap. Give me some. Give me a mainstream song right now. Fine, go.
A rap? Or. Okay.
Not somebody that's like woke.
J. Cole.
No. I'm talking about this new.
So I can't use Kendrick?
No.
Okay.
That's a different genre now.
Nah. Okay.
Well, no. The thing, like I said, like you listen to like the little
pumps.
You listen like YoungBoy. The YoungBoy. It's kind of name is stupid. YoungBoy Never Broke Again. That's his name. So, but I'm gonna just say,
YoungBoy,
the dude depressed, bro. When I say, man, his songs, I be like, God, dang, boy, you need to go to the doctor. But no, nah, he really be putting his. He be putting this. He be crying on them boys. So I be like, dang, it's crazy. It's crazy. But it ain't too many. But. Right now, it's a lot of depressed songs out here with a good beat on there. You just don't know.
Yeah, like.
I don't know. I don't know if it's because we're older, because I feel like these kids feel these songs in a very different way.
That's because they're depressed. That's because.
That's what I say. It's a depressing song.
It's a lot of stuff going on, and especially because, like, this culture has, like, glorified being in this deep coma of medicated bliss.
I was saying, I don't know what it is. Yeah, did to now, you know, you pop, everybody talking about being a crackhead.
Man, like.
It's cool now.
Used to be a time where it was fight the power. You know what I'm saying? We wasn't doing
absolutely.
That. Then you had the drug dealer, but we didn't praise.
They were selling it.
It was selling it. He was trying to get out the hood.
The drug dealer music created the drug user music.
Yeah, but no.
You don't think so?
No, I agree.
Yeah.
You agree, Cody?
Absolutely.
I completely agree with you. Yes.
I mean, it did, but we was. What did he say on Paid in Full when
I don't know
when Mitch was like when he was talking to his uncle and he was like I gave you to sell it to make money not to use it like
right but think this is my thought process and I could be completely wrong. I feel like the drug dealer music, these guys were just out here living life
talking about selling it.
Correct. Absolutely. You're talking about selling it, but nobody was home with these kids. Nobody was telling these kids, like, hey, maybe you shouldn't be using it. But you were also selling to their mom. And they were seeing their mom use it.
Well, right now, some of these kids, they mom ain't never used nothing. To me, the thing that actually jumped to the all the extra stuff, because at first, I mean, you hear about it in the game, like the rap game, they was all crack kids or something. You hear about it, they be like, oh, yeah, this person, Tina Turner or Whitney, they all was all using all this stuff. You hear about they all was on it.
They had Shane back
Coke
then, though.
Or something.
You didn't know that they.
Yeah, yeah. But now, to me right now, the thing is, what crossed it over was Lean. So Lean was cool. It was in a wrap, and you get two cups, you the man.
Get your double cup.
So now you in a double cup, and then when the person was like, got the double cup, and I popped me a Sprite, bought me a bill.
Yeah,
then you had another person like, dang, what the? What kind of pill is he popping?
Yeah.
So then, like I say, because to me it's crazy. I told people I'm not paying you no money to go to sleep, because to me that's what Lean is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not about to give you $500 to take a nap. Naps is free. You feel me? You got to be messed
up.
I used to fight those when I was young.
Hey,
now you tell me I'm paying for it?
Like sidebar, have you ever got to a point where when you lay down, and you was like, why did I not want to go to sleep as a child? Like, this is amazing. Like,
and how can I cash in on all
all the times I was up to 2 o'clock in the morning fighting sleep? How can I get that back? But yeah.
I want all of my sleep now.
Yeah, these guys now, they, like I say, that's where they feelings at. They feelings is being high in a mug, so they feel a different way. They feel sad, because I feel like being high, it's making them sad or something. Whatever the pills they taking, the drugs they taking, make them feel sad, so they rap about sad
stuff. But it's to a point now where we just have to, somebody has to take note, because two people died. You had what, Mac Miller, mm-hmm. And then...
Yeah, it's Mac Miller.
Somebody else died.
The other person got killed. He got killed, though.
He got killed, though.
But, I mean, like... It gets to a point now where we got to take heed. Like, somebody has to be that person and say, okay.
I ain't taking nothing, man. Listen, I seen Five Heartbeats when he said,
nights like this,
I wish
die. Angels with my.
Hey, look, I got
that's
it.
All it took me to not take nothing.
That's so funny. Look, tell him I got it, man.
That's it. Nah, I mean, what else?
Or New Jack. When you sing trying to get off
but
of
I
it.
Feel like we grew up doing that drug dealer music time though.
Yeah, but you
so
had,
for us it's like, oh no, you can't do that. No,
you
I'm
still
not
got people still
guy.
Trying to do it. It's just some people think it's cool. Cause like I say, it's just some people like me. I'm scared of stuff. So mm-hmm. like, all I had to do was see that movie. All I had to see was Ezell talking about he'd clean up smoky stuff for $2. It only took me to see that and be like, oh, nah. It took me a motorcycle. I ain't never ride no motorcycle because I fell off a regular bicycle before.
And that hurt.
I'm not falling off of that. So I'm just one of them scary people. You got people, you know, like, man, jail? I do 20 years. Me? Well, all you had to do was tell me I was going to get raped. I'm not doing nothing.
I'm good.
I'm light-skinned. I can't go to jail.
I'm not doing nothing. His arm is bigger than me. I'm good. You feel me? I'm good. You tell me I got to be in here for the next 20. I'm good. People in here happy over Doritos? Oh, no.
That's all it takes?
These boys is in here having a party, posting on their internet, getting in trouble because they got snacks. Oh, nah. Nah.
Not you?
Nah, I'm good, bro. I'm still being happy over having TV and going to the store myself. I'm good. Commissary.
Doritos, whatever you want.
Our outside time, free play. You
to me, I'm good. People be, like I say, I hear all the rappers. It's cool, but it ain't cool to me. I'm not about to say I'm cool because I've been to jail. I'm good. I'm straight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I never wanted that.
Like a badge of honor.
I never wanted that.
Not to me.
Like, I never wanted that. Like,
to me, I'd be like, so I'm supposed to think you cooler than me
because
you got caught.
Yeah. Because
you got caught. So let's break this all the way down. Mm-hmm. So your credibility is way better than mine because you got caught slipping.
Yeah. So that's like, and then it's like, when did that become cool? Because it's like, if I did something at home, I got in trouble, and my daddy take me in a room and beat the brakes off me, I never came outside like,
yeah,
I did. I just got beat.
I did that.
These are my whips on my back. No, my friends was laughing at me.
Battle cards.
Came out to your siblings like, I did that, so y'all have to go through that.
Like, no, everybody was laughing and pointing, yeah. Making me even more mad.
Hot.
Yeah, you wanted to beat up your little brother because he kept giggling.
Snickering so hard, like, too. And you red, you snotting at the nose.
No. I don't know when do you cross over to getting caught, getting in trouble was cool because, like I say, getting beat wasn't cool.
Mm-mm.
Nah.
That's mm-mm. crazy.
So, I'm good.
That's crazy.
My music sound different. Like I say, it's more, it's my story. Like I say, I got a song on there. I'm talking a little bit crazy in there because that's what I did. But it took one time.
That's all you really need.
One time
good
at Bandcamp.
Oh, yeah. It took one time. Something happened.
Oh, this is what happened. Oh, for real? Oh, okay.
Oh, no. And I didn't even get in trouble by the police. It just was the life. Like, one time I got caught slipping.
You had a glimpse of what could be.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. One time, yeah. It was like, oh. Everybody was asking why I wasn't mad. I was playing 2K. I'm talking about 3 hours later. They was like, man, you tripping. Like, I'm like, boy. I'm done.
That's it. I'm over.
That I've been scared
it.
Straight.
I'm getting a jizz out. Got me messed up.
You know, what you doing? I just put about 6 jobs in on Indeed. It's over. I'm not living that life. That's not for me.
Yeah, that's what I was on.
So that's what's up. All right, we're going to wrap up in a minute. Anything that you would like to say? So let's run out a couple of things because you wear many hats. So to the inspiring entrepreneur, what tips would you give to them?
Just do. If you don't go and do it, you're not going to ever do it. I'm talking about get up and go do it. That's it. To me, that's the main thing. Because starting something is and everybody that know if they fall off from working out, the worst day is the first day.
Worst day mm-hmm. is the first day back.
Because it took everything in you to get off the couch, get in your car, drive, get to the place, get out. And work out. And that's probably the shortest workout you ever did, too.
Yeah, a hot 20 minutes.
Good 20.
Yeah, you in and out that boy, but you be feeling strong in the mug the next day.
You done went and ate a burger like, I worked out yesterday.
So it's the same thing with being, you know, if you go and get your name, patent and all that stuff to you, I'm telling you, once you get to the crib the next day, you feel good. Like, dang, I did that. This name belonged to me now.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then you just, it'll get you jogging.
Okay. So what is what tips do you have someone that wants to break into become an artist like this? That's not just a rapper, to become an artist.
Anything in music right now, release everything. If you're a producer, give your beats away. If you're a rapper, singer, just release it. Right now, trying to get a deal and hold on to your stuff is stupid. The more people you get to look at you on Instagram or your social media, the faster you'll get it. Mm-hmm. Example, Catch Me Outside, girl. She said, Catch Me Outside. Now you can catch her outside in that Lambo thing. So,
Wait, what? She getting that?
Oh, seat? She signed. She signed with Cardi B now. Yeah. She right with her.
Getting
they all
check.
Signed. Major deal.
You talking about Catch Me Outside?
Yes. Mm-hmm. She got songs with everybody. Little Black Youngs, everybody. Future. She got songs with everybody.
Yeah, like that original. Like that original phrase. The one from from the
Cash
court?
Me Outside. You check her on her gram, she probably got about 20 million followers. Mm-hmm. Wow. The thing is, right now, you don't have to have talent. So if you somehow tell jokes or fall or do whatever,
marketable.
You can just you can just fall and slip and get beat up. People will follow you.
Yeah,
if you get a million view followers from anything, I'm talking about from eating cabbage. You got to think that's a million people that like you for eating cabbage. So when you do something more than eating cabbage, like I'm deciding to rap today, that's a million people. So maybe 100,000 of them might buy a $7 EP that you drop. You ain't gonna get seven, but you're gonna get $3. Mm-hmm. That's $300,000 that just dropped in your bank account for something that you never was planning on doing.
And you don't really have to say much.
And you don't have to say nothing because they like you for getting. They like you for eating a pretzel in the first place.
Yeah.
Like I said, the bar
is pretty low.
Yeah. Very. She said, "Catch Me Outside." She got a following. She dropped some music. You got 5 million followers, and you get $400,000 to buy your $3, your $7 EP. You get $3. That's a nice check.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So it's about your followers. Let it all out.
Okay.
It's like the Kardashian effect.
Yeah. Quit holding everything. Keep spilling.
The Kardashian effect. We gonna coin that here.
Yeah.
Everybody get caught in the Kardashian effect.
Spill it. Spill it all.
Make your money.
Hey. All right, Bob. How can people reach out to you for Glass Guy? How can they get you for a track? How can they get you for a show? Like put it out there.
Man, Glass Guy. 313-732-8256, and you can call the glass guy, and I will pull up to your house or your job and put your windshield, back glass, door glass, fender, anything in your car that got wind glass on it, I will put it in your car. Just call me, 732-8256. That is a 313 area code.
You just can't be number six that calls. You might get pushed.
You might get pushed.
You might get pushed to tomorrow, but guess what? You saved $200.
That's worth it.
And what about for the music?
The music, you can catch me on Instagram, Facebook. You just put me in your URL. You type in B-O-B.
Oh, we out here like that now.
B-O-B space S-H-E-L-B, as in Bobby, Bob Shelb. You can put me anywhere. If you type it anywhere in Google, your URL, I don't care what it is, I will be the first two or three pages. Just me, period. I'm everywhere. You type it in your URL. It will pop up on your YouTube, just like your favorite artist. It's going to pop up a black page just like them. It's going to pay all of me.
And was that because you flooded the market, or did you pay for that?
I pay for my name. I own me. Same thing like if you Tina Turner and then how Ike owned her and she had to go to court to get her name back. I own the name Bob Shelb, so it's me. So, like, you got all these actors and stuff. Some of these actors, I don't think Jamie Foxx's name is really Jamie Foxx.
It's not.
Yeah. He had to change his name because somebody else was already making money off the name. So, you can't use your real name because it'll pull away from their look. So, if somebody type in
Eric Bishop. Why I know that? I'm sorry. I don't know.
That's his name?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, if somebody type in Eric Bishop, it might be an Eric Bishop who sells laptop computers, but he's patenting. People look up Eric Bishop for laptop computers. If Jamie Foxx came out as an actor, that take away from him so he can sue Jamie Foxx. So that is his name. Jamie Foxx can't be a business. So Jamie Foxx had to change his name to Jamie Foxx as the business. Like that. So my name is Bob Shelb, the business, the artist. So that's why if you type me in, it's just me.
And you did that through Google?
I did that through all the outlets, music outlets, TuneCore and everything, published my name and everything. So just make sure it was me.
That's a whole another conversation. I didn't know you had to go through all that.
I know music is crazy. When I say,
because that not even just for music. Anything that you're doing, like even as a
anything.
Yeah, because I would want to, basically you coining your name.
Yeah, It's people out there that make $1 million off of stealing you. So people who, like, say you start this radio show and you named it after you, your first and last name.
Right.
If somebody seen you getting a glimpse of fame on it, they go make a .com of your name.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? They will go and make bobshelp.com, bobshelp.net, bobshelp.one.net. They will try to coin 100, 200, 300 of them where when I'm like, oh, dang, we blowing up. We need to make a website.
Now,
they will charge you $300,000, $400,000 for your own name. Mm. Yeah. They ain't playing with you. It's people literally to just sit up and steal other people's name all day, every day.
I think that's why a lot of celebrities don't release their kids' names until they go get that.
Yeah, you got to. I'm telling you, because people will steal their name. Cause
buying the rights to a name, that's a whole other show.
If somebody knew Trayvon Martin was going to pass away that day, man, I'm telling you, they would have went and .com Trayvon Martin 1,000,000 times before their parents could have did it. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It's some people who own it quick. That was Ed Lover, the comedian. He had the little phrase. I forgot what it was called.
Come on, son.
Yeah. He had to buy that back, man, for like $1,000,000, man, because he used to say, come on, son, thing, man. And everybody used to put up the sign, come on, son, come on. He had to buy that, come on, son. Somebody bought comeonson.net, comeonson.com, son, come on. They bought everything where he couldn't use it, and that was his phrase. He needed that phrase. So he had to buy it back.
That's a hustle in and of itself.
Oh, no, it's a hustle. People literally make millions just stealing other people's names.
Doing nothing.
And not to keep the show going too long, but we got some good content going. But that's what happened with, I guess, was it Cards Against Humanity or something? They went and bought all the rights to, like, the old 90s shows and stuff like that. Like, I think it was, like, Martin. And it was, like, no one had it. And they wouldn't. Bought the
so nobody else can use the stuff, right, yeah. Content. Yeah, I'm telling you, man, it's bling. So you heard Bird, man? Like, man,
I should have did
because, man, you know how much money you would have made on bling.
So that's a whole nother topic of how do you coin a phrase though?
Say
you
own
just
it.
Have to
go downtown.
Using it, I guess.
No, you just go register it as mine.
Register a phrase.
Yeah, you can register it as mine. Yeah,
I know Paris Hilton did. That's hot. I know that's like an old reference, but.
Man, that's mine. You know what I'm saying? People, man. Same thing with the music. Like I said, I did my name, so that's why if you type me in, you're going to get me.
Okay.
You're going to get nobody but me.
All right. Okay.
All right.
So, how can people get at you if they want to get at you?
I'm on Instagram.
Oh, okay.
T Kiara.
Okay.
T K I A R A.
Okay. All right, T Kiara. You got any last words? Last questions for Bob Shelp.
I would like to know, you seem well-versed on the business side of things. Where'd that come from?
I don't know. I can show you a message I did earlier today. I actually wanted to start a business on that, too. I just think I got good ideas. Always had good ideas.
Well, no, like, I'm saying, like, knowing.
The knowledge. Where did you attain the knowledge?
Correct.
I don't think I just think it's something to everything. You're not just about to go into NBA and think you're going to be an NBA player and then just make all this money and not pay taxes. Like, I always think something got to give. You got to give something to get something. So, I just feel like.
So, you search for it before you.
Yeah. Like, you
gotta, do your Googles.
Yeah, I just feel like everything you do, like a radio show like this, is like, let me make sure. I do this radio show.
Oh yeah, we're branded. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just,
yeah. I bought the rights.
What if somebody see this and then right, they go take it? I'm always scared somebody gonna steal from me. So
it was a couple of stories about that where people got because DVE they had an issue where when they came out with the Detroit versus everyone. And then I think New York versus everyone came out, and Miami versus everyone.
Yeah, a lot of guys were trying to steal it.
Yeah, they were trying to steal it, and they went and got them trademark rights and came back for all of it.
No, see, I didn't even know that. Yeah. The only thing about those, like, that's crazy. I just did another podcast, like, about 2 weeks ago, not a radio, just a podcast.
Mm-hmm.
They talked about that, and we talked about fashion because there was a fashion guy in there. He got his own clothing line. And man, man, I be chopping in on every little business. But I had told them, like, I did a lot of fashion shows this year on performing when I did my music. I can't do the strip club. My music what I'm gonna do? Make they gonna cry, you know?
Right.
They're gonna get the dance.
It's gonna be a whole lot of sad dancers.
So I did like fashion shows and stuff, and then like I got bored real fast. A lot of people had T-shirts with their name on them and called it a line. And I'm like, man, how is that a clothing line? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? No, that is a
T-shirt brand.
Brand. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's just a brand.
People try to say it's a lifestyle brand.
Yeah. I'm like, man, why do... So when people was trying to get me to buy their stuff, I always ask, like, why do I want to wear your name? Yeah. Like, tell me, why do I want to wear your name? Or should I just go buy me some T-shirts and put Bob on the front, too? You know what I'm saying? I was just telling all of them, like, you got to... If you want a line, man, you got to change something. You keep calling it a line. A line is T-shirt. That's the line. Somebody created the T-shirt. Then somebody created the hoodie. That's the line. You putting a brand on somebody else's line. I kept trying to tell them that. You sticking your brand on somebody else's line. Gucci is a brand of a line. Like, Gucci, they're putting a print on a T-shirt. Somebody created the T-shirt. That was the creation. Then you put your brand on their stuff.
I guess the disconnect is the line of clothing. When they say a line, I guess it's the different facets of clothing. Like, this is a clothing line, because it's like Gucci is a clothing line.
But if you don't create nothing, I don't see how it's a line. So, like, I see Gucci and them, they still create right. certain yeah. things. They got these, because they just be looking crazy at their fashion shows. Yeah. I don't even know what they be wearing. Mm-hmm. But, like, people in the city, man, I be like, bro, you got a T-shirt with your name on it.
So, in that aspect, if they just had several different styles of a T-shirt.
To me, what you do is, you know how we had baggy pants.
Right.
Then they came out with the slim pants with the little biker type, a little stripe around the knee.
Yeah.
That was something new. Now, if you was the first person to do that, you would have been killing. If you was the first person to get the shirts with the, you know, with that little leather stripe through them,
mm-hmm.
now you killing. But you coming out with just plain T-shirts with your name on them, and selling them for $25, and I can go to Forever 21 and get me a great T-shirt for $3.99. I'm sorry. I just be telling people, like,
and
bro.
And the bad part about it, the tags probably the same.
No, all the tags are the same, I promise. All the tags are the same. I checked it out. I do it. I looked at it. Everything, man. Like, y'all, man. We talked about that a lot, man. The dude that was there, he was like, man.
He was a little upset.
No. He actually was happy. He was like, man, you taught me some stuff. Because he was kind of older. But he was just like, man, you made me think about it in a different aspect. You know what I'm saying? You asking people to do stuff. For what? You know, for what? You know, people stupid. So it's like, we all dumb. I'm wearing, you know, I be wearing $150 T-shirt sometime because it say Gucci on it. But it's still a T-shirt. I'm still sweating in it. Mm-hmm. But the brand is worth something. So my thing is, I'm stupid because I bought the brand, but the brand at least made me look like the man. So
the Gucci, brand gave you something.
The brand gave me something. So I still walked outside and it was like, dang, you spent that on that. You
shit. Boy.
You know what I'm saying?
Got some change in your pocket.
Man, yeah. You did. So it was like that. But if I just wear you,
I'm going to be looking like.
No. I'm not spending $25. Then some of them be wanting $60, $70 for this. Or what, cuz?
Then you gotta explain to everybody what you have on. So you're doing.
But if it was sweet,
for them.
If it just looked sweet and it was cold, then that's different. But a lot of them just have a plain hoodie.
With a small logo.
Look, that's it. That's it.
And you haven't developed and you haven't made your mark where you can take this small logo and I'ma see it from a distance. Man. Like, oh, you got that Bob Shelby on.
I just told a dude to try to sell me a T-shirt for $35. I said, bro, how about you just go sell them boys for $2, $3, and just flood everybody with a T-shirt?
Yeah.
So when everybody everybody in the T-shirt, then you can, but when everybody start calling you for a T-shirt, now people are calling you for the T-shirt. So now you can say it's $10.
You've set the demand.
When people, then you sell it just a little bit more, I mean a little bit less for the $10, then people want it. Bro, I'm running out. It's going to cost you $25. And that's how you go. And then once you get it to the popular person and the popular person want to wear it, you give it to them and they look good in it. Now people calling you because they just saw Dej Loaf in your shirt. Now you can say, okay, that's $60.
Supply and demand.
Yeah, it's like, bro, you can't let somebody see it in your hand and then you think you're going to sell it for this. If you want to start off up high, just go straight to the internet. So at least people can't see it. People buy more. People spend more for what they can't see.
It's the buzz around it.
I agree with that.
Yeah, it's the buzz around it. Like
you got an interesting perspective.
Yeah,
you have to create the buzz around it. All right, well, we're gonna have to bring you back, man. We got a lot of stuff we can bounce.
Oh yeah, because I got a line I'm gonna have to bring out too.
Oh, you about to drop a line?
And I promise, I'm actually gonna change something. I'm gonna create something though.
Okay.
You'll hear about it. It's called.
All right, just to pay some bills, everybody. Tomorrow on campus there is a Detroit College Fair. It's gonna be at the Mathi Physical Education Center. It's gonna be from 9:30 to 1 p.m. Once again, we have an event. Anybody that's looking for a job or looking to college, things of that nature, is going to be at the Mathi tomorrow, so you can check into that. Once again, my name is Jay Liggs, and I am your host of The Culture Cure. It's been a blast. It's been a blast. You can follow me on all platforms at Jay Liggs, J-A-Y-L-I-G-G-S, or you can follow The Culture Cure Show. The Culture Cure and Show, like it's said. And that's been our time, and we appreciate Bob Shell for coming in. We got to get you back, man. You got a lot of stuff we can bounce off each other. But we appreciate y'all, and that's our time.
Have a good night.